Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to Healing X Outreach Radio. I am your host, Augustine Astacio. And once again, this is Passion Week. This is the week where we celebrate the life and times of Jesus Christ. Tomorrow's Easter Sunday, and we have a wonderful debate lined up for today. Before we go into the specifics of today's debate, just want to let you know about other programming we have planned further on. After this week, this Wednesday, just want you to know, we're doing a retake on the live stream that we had done about a week ago on Jesus and the Trinity in the Old Testament. And so that will be on Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Check us out on our archives and also future programming by subscribing to us at blogtalkradio.com/healing, the letter X, outreach. That's blogtalkradio.com/healing, the letter X, outreach. And it will be a live stream event, so you can check us out on YouTube at 6:30 p.m. this Wednesday coming up. And also you can listen to it on Blog Talk. I know that the current copy that we currently have, It's really bad sound, so we will be replacing it with a much better copy, which we're going to do on Wednesday. After that, next week, on next Saturday, we will have a Oneness Pentecostal, or at least former Oneness Pentecostal, Ralph Ricky, and he will share his story out of a Oneness Pentecostal cult. And then on May, that is on, I believe, May the 4th, you will get to hear me in a debate as a participant, and Jeremy Shepard's going to moderate that debate. It will be between me and Bonnie Wilder, who is an atheist, but she will be debating, holding on to the position that the Old Testament Jehovah is actually Satan the devil, and I will be taking the negative on that position, and she will be taking the positive. And then we have, I believe, on May the I believe it's the 11th, I'm not sure, May the 12th, don't have it right now on schedule, but it should be sometime in May, I think the week after, I will be doing another live stream. It will be May the 11th. I will be doing a live stream on difficult biblical questions, you know, stuff that people feel that the Bible has some inconsistencies on, so that will be a live stream event. We'll talk about how many people were at the resurrection. We'll talk about certain passages in the Old Testament that are repeated. All kinds of things. Little biblical difficulties on the live stream on May the 11th. That will be a live stream on YouTube and on Blog Talk Radio. But today we have a debate planned, and we want to welcome our guests on the debate. Is Jesus God? Between apologist Shadid Lewis and Catholic apologist William Albrecht. Just to give you a little information, Shadid Lewis, he's a Muslim apologist from the Muslim Debate Initiative, and he will be taking the negative position in today's debate. You can learn about him at, that is, thedebateinitiative.com, and also on Facebook at facebook.com/Muslim Debate Initiative. You can learn a little bit about Shadid and what they're doing at the Muslim Debate Initiative. William Albrecht, he's a Catholic apologist, and he has a BA in theology. He's a member of the Catholic Apostolic Catholic Legate. You can find out more about him on YouTube and at catholic-legate.com, youtube.com/GNRhead, and godtube.com/Catholic. And just a little bit about the rules of today's debate. For both of our gentlemen, I know William is aware of it. He's done several debates here on Healing X Outreach, but our debates are formatted, and so we will have 2 7-minute openings, and I will take it whoever's having the the positive position will start to debate, I think.
Yes,
and
correct.
We have 5-minute rebuttals. Then we will have six-minute cross-exams where each member has three cross-exams apiece to question the other. And then we will have 2 7-minute closings, and then we'll take 24 minutes from you, the listeners and callers, to ask either Shadid Lewis or William Albrecht any questions concerning the debate topic and today's debate on Is Jesus God. So I want to welcome both of the gentlemen here onto this debate format. Hello, Shadid, are you there?
Hello, can you hear me now?
Oh, okay. That's you, Shadid.
Can you hear it?
Yeah, I hear you now. Yep. And William?
Clearly. Yes, I am here.
All right, so we got you both also. Okay, so we got you both now. And so William, you're taking the positive position, so you should start the debate. Am I not correct?
That's correct. I'll be opening, and Shadid will be getting the closing.
All right, great. So is everybody hearing me just fine also? Just want to be clear.
Oh, yeah.
All right,
great.
Yeah, I'm heard good, all right? You guys can hear me good?
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Good. All right, great.
Okay.
So whenever you want to begin, William, your time will start as soon as you begin.
Okay, let me get my timer, and I will start with my 7-minute opening now. Today we will examine whether or not the ancient scriptures, the Old and the New Testament, give witness to Jesus as Almighty God. Today we will walk down the hallowed halls of the historical word, the divine paradosis, to see how the first followers of Jesus viewed their resurrected Messiah. In Mark's gospel, we read him apply Isaiah 40 to Christ, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Mark here identifies Christ as Yahweh, and make no mistake, Mark knew the Hebrew and the Septuagint texts very, very well, as he shows great proficiency with the Word of God. As the great Julius Africanus tells us, the earliest Christians were very well versed in the Greek and the Hebrew, thus evinced with the overwhelming flow of Hebrew Christians into the early church. Mark is very careful to make the clear connection with the divine Yahweh as being the one mentioned in Daniel 7. Christ's dominion never ends, and he has to be worshipped. Only God receives worship of the highest form, latri in Latin, latru in Greek, in the Bible. Today, my friend Shadid will have to deal with that in a cogent manner. In Mark 14, 61-64, we read the account of the interrogation of Jesus. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And Jesus said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." And the high priest tore his garments and said, "What further witnesses do we need? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" And they all condemned him as deserving death. Now, the Son of Man is a clear reference back to Daniel 17:13-14. The divine figure seen by Daniel is to receive worship by the whole world. So who was Daniel? Well, Daniel was an Israelite prisoner of war. While being put to work for the king in a slave-like manner, he had a vision. In the vision, he sees two thrones in heaven. Worship given to each that sits on the thrones is in order. He has a vision. He sees into God's throne room. Mark that down. He sees into God's throne room. He sees more than one divine throne. He sees this figure, the Son of Man. He sits down on the divine throne, ruling the world. Latruo is given to him, and this is not an ordinary human. This is why, when interpreting Daniel and his Son of Man that Mark hearkens to, every single father saw this as referencing Jesus the Christ. In fact, not just every father, but even the enemies of the faith. Arius never pounced on this passage to attack the faith, and Nestorians and those from the earliest Arabic nations all recognized Jesus as the prophetic figure spoken of here. In fact, qualities, attributes exclusive to God Almighty, exclusive to Allah, are listed in the Quran that line up directly with Jesus the Christ. The Quran 57:4 says, "He is the first and the last, the ascendant and the intimate, and he is of all things knowing." Christ, of course, is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. The Quran 22:6 says, "That is because Allah is the truth and because he gives life to the dead and because he is over all things competent." Christ is the truth, of course, and he is the one that raises the dead. The Quran 3:135 says, and those who, when they commit an immorality or wrong themselves, remember Allah and seek forgiveness for their sins. And who can forgive sins except Allah? And who do not persist in what they have done while they know? Mark 2, for Christ forgives sins. John 20, Christ forgives sins. The book of James, Christ forgives sins. Polycarp, Irenaeus, they all testify that Christ forgave sins, and the ultimate forgiver of sins is Yahweh, Jesus the Christ. But as we will see clearly, not only did the New Testament writers identify Jesus as Almighty God, but so did the writers, the Christian writers that followed after them. It is no wonder that today when we read our creed, what our creeds say about Jesus, we hearken to Titus 2:13, where we read, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our great God and Savior Christ, our great God that emptied himself. As Philippians 2 tells us, emptied himself in the form, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth. The hymn to Christ is of fundamental importance for a Christian because it is an ancient tradition, predating Paul. The most reliable scholars tell us that this hymn actually comes from around the time of the resurrection. This would in turn mean that the earliest followers of Christ, those that fought against the heresy, those that fought against modalism, those that fought against Gnosticism, believed in his divinity. And indeed, even the enemies of the faith, as we will see later, Akiba and all those, they recognized which movement came from Christ. Funny enough, the enemies of the faith recognized which movement came from Christ, as they hence pretty much tossed Gnosticism and so many others to the side, almost completely ignoring them and putting their condemnations on the group that believed Jesus to be deity. This hymn to Christ is attested to by Epiphanius, the great Athanasius, the great church historian Eusebius, the immovable bishop Augustine, the golden mouth Chrysostomos, Gregory of Elvira, the great Eusebius, and so many more. Monotheistic Judaism strongly influenced these early Christians. You see the very works that the earliest Christians in the New Testament and after adopted as evidence of the eternal generation of the Son in wisdom are very proofs of this. And this is why we can read just what Melito of Sardis says, what Justin say, what all these individuals say, where they connect all the texts with Jesus the Christ. And I have about 10 seconds in my opening statement left. I will surrender the rest of my time to Shadid. I look very forward to dialoguing with him in a very peaceful manner. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Just to let both people know, Shadid and William, so you can be aware this is a debate ring. This means your time is up. So, whenever you don't need to cut it yourself off. You just go ahead and continue on and try to just, it's kind of a wrap-up ring, so try to wrap it up as soon as you're able to upon hearing that ring. That means your time has then elapsed.
Okay.
So we're not real strict about it, you know. You want to make sure you get your thought completely out. So, alrighty. So now, Shadid, you have your opening statement.
All right. First of all, can I be heard good?
Yes. Sound loud and clear.
Okay. All right. Very good. Okay. Well, the Islamic position is very clear about Jesus. For example, in the Quran, chapter 5, verse 75, makes it pointedly clear that Jesus, the Messiah, the son of Mary, was only a messenger. Other messengers had indeed gone before him. In chapter 43, verse 59 of the Quran, it states very clearly, speaking of Jesus, that he was naught but a servant of Allah on whom we bestowed favor. We made him an example for the children of Israel. So the Quran is very clear. William had mentioned that some of the attributes that are in the Quran that are given to Allah are given to Jesus in another scripture. But however, the Quran makes it clear that the miracles and things that Jesus had performed were done by the permission of Allah. That's chapter 3, verse 49. So the Quran makes it clear that whatever miracles Jesus did, not only Jesus but other prophets, were done by the permission of God. He couldn't do it on his own. And we see this example given us in the Bible as well, in chapter John chapter 5, verse 30, where Jesus says, "Of myself, I can do nothing. He does the will of the one who sent him." So this is clear that this is obviously not the speech of one who is the mighty God, the supreme being, the creator himself. He doesn't speak like that. We see that, and this is what I like to do. I like to look at what the person themselves is alleged to have claimed rather than looking at what other people say about people. Because, you know, we have all that time where people will say things or believe things about people. For example, quick example, when President Obama was president, people believed that he was a Muslim. The Tea Party would claim that, hey, Obama's a Muslim and this and that. But when Obama himself spoke, Obama would say, well, you know, I'm a Christian. You see? So I like to usually go by what the person is alleged to have said, as best as we could determine. So let's take a look at what Jesus was alleged to have said. For example, very clearly in John chapter 8, verse 40, these words are attributed to Jesus saying that it is that you are looking for a way to kill me, a man who told you the truth that I heard from God. Okay? Very clear statement. Very clear statement. And the word that's used here for man is not man as in the male gender. It is as in a human being, anthropo or anthropos, meaning a human being. In fact, this word, when you look at the definition, it says that this word distinguishes man from God, man from animals and other creatures. Key point, it distinguishes man from God. So these words are attributed to Jesus, making it very clear that he is a man, or human being rather, that they are trying to kill, distinguishing himself from God. In fact, the rest of the sentence shows that, where he says that he heard the truth from God, clearly showing us that God is obviously someone other than Jesus himself. All right. We see other examples of this. For example, where Jesus says that he has a God, right? In John chapter 20, verse 17, it is said that Jesus said, speaking to Mary Magdalene, to go back to tell his brothers that he's returning to his father and their father and to his God and their God. This is clearly not the speech of one who thinks himself to be the mighty God himself. Yahweh never spoke like that. Yahweh never spoke of himself having a God over himself and that his God was the God of the children of Israel. No, he told the children of Israel that he was their God. But here Jesus is saying, look, I have a God, and my God, the God of me, is also the God of you. Okay? Other examples of this, we see John 17:3, where it is said that Jesus speaking to God. Now, he's speaking to God. It's interesting that it says that this is life eternal, that they might know you, he's talking to God, that they might know you, the only true God. And who am I? I'm Jesus Christ, Messiah, whom you, the only true God, have sent. You see? So I like to look at things this way to see that what is the person themselves alleging to say, regardless of what other people believe about you or say about you, what are you claiming about yourself? So we see here that these are examples where these are alleged statements of Jesus speaking that he has a God, that his God is the God of himself and the God of his followers, that he does not have the power to do these things on his own. He does the will of the one who sent him. Very clearly making it clear, speaking to God, that you are the only true God and I am the Christ. Christ just means, is the Greek or the Latin of Messiah, the one who anointed of God. You see? Very clear statement. Now, what about, now we can take a look at what some people said about him. And a lot of times people will talk about what the earliest followers have claimed to have said. Well, I think we can get a glimpse of that when we look at some of the Christian scriptures, that we may perhaps see a glimpse of what some of the very, very earliest followers perhaps may have thought about Jesus. For example, in Matthew chapter 21, verse 11, we see that as Jesus is gaining popularity, that the crowds are talking about him. And it says here in Matthew 21:11 that the crowds answered that this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. So they refer to him as the prophet. They don't say that this is Jesus, this is God right here. We see in Matthew chapter 21, verse 46, when they were looking for a way to arrest him, that that they said that they looked for a way to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowd. Why? Because the crowd held that he was a prophet. They didn't think that this man was God himself. They said, this is a prophet here, all right? We see another example when they saw him perform miracles and do the work that he did. They didn't say, oh, look, this is God standing here. According to Matthew chapter 9, verse 8, it says, when the crowd saw this, meaning Jesus performing some of these miracles, they were filled with awe, it says. Why? And they praised God, why? Who had given such authority to man. So it appears that some of the very, very, very earliest followers of Jesus did not take him for God. They understood that this man was a prophet. They understood that this man was a man sent by God. They understood that this man had been given authority, that God had given authority to such a man. But notice, as it says here, that they praised God who had given such authority to a man. Not that this man was God himself or that God was right here and standing in front of us doing these things. No, they understood that Jesus was a man that was sent by God. And, of course, why wouldn't they believe that when in many verses he said he was the one that was sent, right? There are many verses where Jesus clearly makes it clear that he's the one that was sent over and over again. For example, everyone I'm sure is familiar with the story of Lazarus when he raises Lazarus from the dead. But he doesn't do it on his own. It says after he performs the miracle, it says that he looks up to heaven, right? He looks up to heaven, and he begins to speak. Who is he talking to, right? He's talking to God, and he says, I thank you, Father. Why? For you always hear me. You hear my prayers. But he says, I did this, why? So that they might know that it was you that sent me. So here he doesn't even want to be mistaken. He doesn't want any mistakes. He says he's doing this so the people will know, speaking to God, that you, he's looking up to heaven. Obviously, somebody's up there that he's talking to, that you sent me. So it's clear that when we look at the words that are attributed to Jesus, allegedly attributed to him, that he's clearly making it clear that he himself is not God, but he is a man that was sent by God. He's doing the will of the one that sent him, which is, of course, doing the will of God. This is why Muslims say that he's a Muslim, not in the sense that he's a Muslim of the modern-day definition of the word, but the foundational meaning, which is one who submits, i.e. submit to the will of God. So, okay, there you go. So those are clear examples of this. Thank you.
All right, thank you, gentlemen, for your opening statements. Now we're going to go into the rebuttal period, and William will have a five-minute rebuttal, and then, Shadid, you will follow William with your five-minute rebuttal. So, William, you can begin your rebuttal. Begin. I will start the timer.
Thank you. Very, very good. Well, we know exactly what the Islamic position is, as Shadid was pointing out, which is why we particularly disagree with it. The statement that Christ was only a messenger is not only erroneous in the sense of the New Testament, it's erroneous in the sense that the enemies of the faith viewed Christ from the perspective of Christ from the faith. So when they were looking in from the outside, they didn't view Christ as only a messenger for the Christians. So that's a big dilemma that Shadid is not going to be able to overcome. It's impossible to overcome. I agree that the Quran doesn't say that Christ is Yahweh. The reason for me utilizing the Quran is to remove the ad hominem type of argument that the Quran doesn't have attributes that we can then line up for Jesus as being God in the Bible. Can do nothing of my own will. Shadid says that this means Jesus was not God. Well, as you're going to read in all of the Gospels, even in Philippians, even in Romans, that is the whole point that Christ is saying. He is united with the Father. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are united. So each one does what they do in accord with the other. That is exactly what Christ says. For instance, when he says that it is not left to the Father to judge, but to the Son, it doesn't mean that the Father in and of himself is not a judge. Everything is done in accord with the other because they are united in that sense. We're told in John 8:40, this is what Jesus says, Shadid says, and listen to this because this is going to be very, very important for our cross-examination because not only is John 40 one of the clearest passages for the deity of Christ, but Shadid is in a world of trouble if he's going to utilize John 8:40 for the position of claiming that Jesus is only a man. Because despite using the Greek anthropos,
what is John, leading up to John 8:40, what are we told? What is being said? He heard the truth. Where did he hear the truth? He says he heard the truth in the presence of the Father. No, this doesn't show he is someone other than God. It shows that we don't believe in modalism. It shows that the Father and the Son are distinct persons, as the Greek shows. We are told that God, we're told that God is not called anthropos. It's really unfortunate. I've heard this argument used many times. It is an argument that has no merit in the biblical text, not only in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament, because if Shadid had actually looked up the text, Genesis 32, Exodus 15, Isaiah 42, Numbers 23, 19, all of them do use anthropos when referring to deity. So that argument, fallacious. That argument has zero truth on its face. There's just absolutely nothing true about it at all. So we're also told that that Christ says that he's going to return to his God. Well, of course he's going to return to God the Father. God the Father is Yahweh. But we're also told that John 17 says that Jesus is the one true God. I mean, excuse me, that God the Father is the one true God. So this in turn would mean that Christ is not the one true God. Unfortunately, the exact biblical Greek phrasing is also found in 1 John 5:20. This is the true God, and eternal life is attributed to Jesus the Christ. So maybe we'll get told, well, you know what, Jesus didn't say that. It was somebody else. Whatever, these aren't the words of Jesus. We can stick to John chapter 17 and prove the deity of Christ from there. But a Christian will not excise certain portions of Scripture and then say, well, we're only going to go with this. We stick with the Word of God, not just the Bible, the historical Word. And Christ is also called the one true God. That is not a term only used for the Father. Matthew 21:11, we read, of course, we read about Christ being called a prophet. Well, guess what? This is sandwiched in between the Son of Man sayings, deity sayings. The prophecy for the Son of Man is for after his resurrection. And guess what? He is making a prophecy in this vision of him as deity in heaven with the Ancient of Days. So in the sense of being called a prophet, we embrace it wholeheartedly. But we don't cut out other portions of the Bible and stick only with little pieces of it. We have to deal with all of the text. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense at all. Of course the Father sent them. That is why Christ himself says, the Father is greater than I, because he is to return to glory to the Father. Thank you.
Okay, we will begin with Shadid's five-minute rebuttal period. As soon as go ahead and speak, you'll have your 5 minutes starts.
All right. Once again, am I heard good?
Yep.
Okay, good. Just wanted to make sure I'm on my phone. All right. So, all right, well, at least William mentioned about the enemy's opinion of Jesus. And again, that's my point. Who goes by the enemy's opinion, right? Democrats who were for Obama, they wouldn't go by the enemy's, the Tea Party's opinion of him, claiming that he's a Muslim or whatever the case. No, they would go by what the man himself is claiming. Who uses it? Because it's understood the enemies already have a bias against the man you support. So, of course, you're not going to go and use the enemy's words and opinions about a man against him. He mentioned that the Quran doesn't say, I wasn't saying that the Quran doesn't say, which we already said. I was saying that the phrases that I was showing that Jesus was saying, that Yahweh in the Old Testament never talks like that. I was saying that the Old Testament doesn't show Yahweh speaking of himself having a God, or Yahweh doing the will of some other person who sent him, or Yahweh being sent. That's the point that was made. Not that the Quran doesn't say it, but that the Old Testament doesn't demonstrate Yahweh speaking the way Jesus is said to have spoken. The other point was about John 8:40, how you said that this would bring trouble. You said that he heard this truth in the presence of the Father. Yet and still, but that's still the point, because what the question of today is Jesus God? And here he's showing that he's not. Even if he did hear it, we know he heard it. Whether he heard it, the point is clear, he heard it from God. So if he heard it in the presence of the Father, why didn't he already know the truth? He said, I heard the truth from. That means from somewhere else, right? If he's supposed to be God, he's supposed to already know the truth, right? God is the all-knowing, right? The most wise. He already knows the truth. But Jesus said I had to hear the truth from somewhere else, i.e., he said it from in that verse, from God, very clearly. So hearing it in the presence of the Father is still saying, I heard it from God, but you still didn't hear it yourself. You didn't know it yourself. God already knows the truth. God doesn't have to hear the truth from anywhere because he is the truth. He's the source of it, correct? But Jesus said, I heard the truth from some other person, some other being, if you will. You mentioned about that God is not anthropos. Well, that's correct. That's a very clear statement. Because we see other places in the Old Testament where Yahweh is making a very strong point to contrast himself between humanity and himself by always letting us know that he is not anthropos. These are examples in Hosea 11:9, makes it clear that God is not anthropos, right? Numbers chapter 23:19, in Ezekiel 28:2, for example. In some of these examples, we see he even condemns others who are anthropos, who are themselves claiming to be God, but God condemns them by saying, no, you are anthropos, and you're not God. You're not the mighty God. So why would now God come as Jesus and then use the very words of which he said that he was not, which is that I'm anthropos, which God said, Yahweh says he's not. So why would Jesus now claim to be anthropos when God said, no, I'm not anthropos? You see? Let's see, what else? Christ called the one. Oh, yeah, you said that Christ was called the one true God. Again, my point about what other people say about the person and what the person themselves says. Christ himself, I don't see where he himself says that I am the one true God myself. Instead, as I showed you, he says that someone else is the one true God, and he is the Messiah, the anointed one of the one true God. So if somebody else called him one true God, well, that's a contradiction, just like with the example of Obama. The Tea Party can call him a Muslim, but Obama says, no, I'm a Christian. So I don't care what you call the other person. I'm looking at what the person themselves says about themselves rather than what other people are saying. And then you were saying that, of course, he was sent. But again, we're talking about God, the supreme being, the almighty one, right? The king, the ruler of all that exists. He's not the one that's sent. He sends the messengers, right? He's always sending prophets and angels and things like that because he's the mighty God himself, you see? He's not the one that's sent. Matter of fact, in Matthew, I believe it's Matthew, what is that, chapter 16, verse 13, where Jesus is actually talking about the one that's sent. The one that's sent is not greater than the one who sent him. So he's showing this example of his subordinate position with the true God, that he's the one that was sent. Why? Because the one that sent is not greater than the one that sent him. And speaking on that point, Jesus makes it clear that the Father is indeed greater than him, John 14:28, right? He makes that point very clear. Clearly, these are the words of a human being who, yes, was given authority by God, sent by God with a prophet and was able to perform miracles, but it's clear that this man speaking is not the mighty God himself. He's clearly acknowledging that there's a greater power than himself, which, again, Yahweh never does. Allah, Yahweh, whatever you want to call it, never does that. There's never an acknowledgement of a greater power than the great power itself, which is Allah, or if you want to call Yahweh, or God. Okay? All right, that's my time. Thank you.
Okay, so we are now entering into the cross-exam period. And so, William, you would have the first shot at cross-examining Shadid, and, of course, as follows, it will alternate. So as soon as you begin your cross-exam, I will start the timer.
Okay, I'm ready now. All right, I want to go directly to John 8, Shadid, because John 8 is so important. And I'm going to go ahead and, before I ask you my question, I'm going to quote your book. On page 12 of your book, you quote John 8:40, and you say these are the words of Jesus. And I'm going to go ahead and read this before we unpack it. You say, as it is, and I'm reading John 8:40 before I read what you say. As it is, you are looking for a way to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. John 8:40, here we have Jesus explaining that you say that first he is a man, and then you say, it does not say that he is both God and man, as many Christians claim, but only mentions clearly that he is a man. So in page 12, and as you've said here, you want to stick with the words of Jesus. Before I ask you the question, let's unpack it a little bit. But now you are trying to kill me, A man who has told you the truth that I heard from God, this is not what Abraham did. So here, Shadid, we've got a present tense action being undertaken. In the Greek, they are trying to kill Jesus. And then we have a past event that Christ lists to contrast what they're trying to do. He says, this is not what Abraham did. Shadid, what is it that Abraham did not do? What is it that Abraham did not do as the past event that Jesus is contrasting here?
Well, according to the verse, he's saying that he is a man that you're trying to, that they're trying to kill, who has told
they're
them the truth that
kill.
He heard from Abraham. That he
right.
heard from God, and said Abraham did not do this. So that is a very interesting question. What did Abraham did not
so
do? Because we are
kill.
Familiar that Abraham, according
right.
to the scriptures, obviously spoke from God as well.
Okay, so they are trying to kill him. And he then says, this is not what Abraham did. Shadid, how long has Abraham been dead at this point?
Excuse me?
About 2,000 years, right? Abraham's been dead about 2,000 years, right, at this point?
Well, longer than now, sure. But, yeah, I guess somewhere around there, yeah.
What is it that Abraham did not do according to the words of Jesus that you acknowledge are the words of Jesus in your book and in your opening and rebuttal? What is it that Abraham did not do?
We're running away. Hold on. We're running away from the point because that's irrelevant. The point was that Jesus is showing that he's not God. That was the point that we got, that we used that reference to show that this is a clear statement where he's saying that he's not God. What Abraham did or didn't do to me is irrelevant in that point. It's really about whether Jesus is God or not.
I know what you used. You thought that jumping on the phrase a man was going to help your argument. I understand that. But you, in your book, you quote this whole verse, and you say these are the words of Jesus. So whether or not you think this is irrelevant, my question to you stands. What is it that Abraham did not do that the Jews are trying to do to Jesus?
That's the point, though. It doesn't matter because his statement is about him being God or not. The subject
don't think it matters. But you think these are the words of Jesus. What is it? Even if you don't think it matters, what is it that Abraham
did not do? Why are you wasting time on that question when we're supposed to be discussing this?
It's my cross-examination. You can ask your own, but this is my cross-examination. What is it that Abraham did not do?
Well, my answer to that is irrelevant.
Trying to do?
It's irrelevant.
It's irrelevant.
That's the answer.
It's irrelevant.
Yes,
okay,
it doesn't answer whether he's God or not.
Wonderful. It's irrelevant. John 8:40 uses the term anthropos. You have made the claim, and you've said it in your book, and you've said it in your debates, that Vine's dictionary says that anthropos makes a clear distinction between man and God. Is that correct?
Yes, correct.
Have you read Vine's? Have you read the whole page, every single usage of anthropos there?
Have I read every single page? No, I haven't read every single page. I read the part that demonstrated that it said that.
Not every page. Just for anthropos, because in every debate of yours that I've heard, in speeches you've given and in your book, you use Vines as an authority
right.
or source, and you say that Vines says that anthropos can only be used for a man. Is that correct?
That it can only be used for a man? I'm not sure if I said that, but in the online edition that I was looking at, because it was part of a Bible website that gave the link where you can see the small portion. I don't know if it gave the whole entry or just a portion of it, but from the portion that I saw, that's the part that I looked at when it mentions those parts that it distinguishes man from animals. Matter of fact, I think I have it in the book.
Do you think
it distinguishes man from animals, and it makes it clear that it distinguishes man from God or humans from God?
Do you think that they are well? Let me try to rephrase it. Is there any lexical source, Strong's, Loanita, Lamps, Vines, any of them say that anthropos is exclusive for man only?
I can answer to that. I haven't looked at all of them, so I can't. Yeah, I can't give a definitive answer to that.
Okay, that's a great answer. You say that you mention it over and over that anthropos is that Jesus uses it, and that this wouldn't be used for God. And, have you read John 8:17-18, where anthropos is used for the Father as well?
In John 17?
John 8:17 says, in your law, the law, it is written that the testimony of two witnesses is valid. And the term used here for witnesses is anthropos. It says, I testify on my own behalf, there's one witness, And then the father who sent me testifies on my behalf. How would you reply? Because you use this in your argument that Anthropos then negates the possibility that Jesus is deity. How do you respond to the fact that the father is also using the term Anthropos for himself here?
Wait a minute, who's talking here? This is who's talking here that's talking about people judging witnesses.
So if I could point to you to about 15 different passages in the Old Testament where Anthropos is also used for God, then show you that there is an exception for Anthropos, that it can be used for deity as well?
Well, wait, hold on. What's the exact context? So you said John 8:17, correct?
Well, John 8:17-18 says that the law requires two witnesses.
Let's use the term for anthropos.
Okay, so you agree that the father is called anthropos.
Let me look at it. It says, it is written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one that beareth witness of myself, and the father that sent me bears witness of me. So you're saying that this is
anthropos for the father.
Right now, well, see, hold up. See, that's the point.
You can cross-examine me. You can get me on that.
Yeah.
You can cross-examine me now.
Yeah, I have to take
it. All right. You have your 6-minute cross-exam. As soon as you go ahead and I'll set the times.
Okay, all right, I'll begin. All right, well, then, since it's not me, I guess that's interesting. I want to continue on that. Because the way I'm looking at this is that it appears that you're taking this statement that in the Mosaic law, that the testimony of two men is true, right? So then the next verse says that here, Jesus says, I am one that bears witness of myself, and the Father that sent me bears witness of me. So it seems to be that you're taking that statement about a general statement about the Jewish law, the Mosaic law, that two men have to be witnesses, and therefore now that Jesus says that he's one witness and that the Father is the other, that this is somehow jumping into making it that the Father is obviously a man. Is that what you're saying?
That's not what I'm saying. The Father must be a man since Jesus used that reference.
Right. Is that what you're saying?
Let me respond to what you're saying. First off, no, I'm not saying the Father is a man. I'm saying that according to your usage of the term anthropos in your opening, your rebuttal, and your book, you've made the claim numerous times that anthropos must mean that the individual cannot be God. And the problem with that, Shadid, is verse 17, Jesus recognizes that they're not going to take his word at face value. So then he says, well, the testimony of two men, according to Exodus, according to Genesis, and many other passages, he's saying, well, okay, so you're not going to take my witness at face value. So I'm one man. And then he says, the Father also testifies for me. Verse 17, he's using anthropos there, and then he connects it by bringing the Father into the picture. So the reason I'm using that, Shadid, is to show that your usage of anthropos to negate the possibility that Jesus can be deity is incorrect, because despite the fact that Jesus uses anthropos, he also uses a lot of other terms that prove the usage of anthropos. Okay, I got your point.
But see,
I disagree with you
because what it seems like you're doing is you're conflating the statement. Yeah, we know Jesus spoke in many. He spoke in the allegorical language. He would speak about his followers as sheep and such. That doesn't mean they're sheep. He spoke about the flock, but this doesn't mean that they were a flock of human beings or, you know, like animals. He's using that type of language. So here I see what you're trying to do is right, because he says that the witness of two men is supposed to be true, and then he says, I'm one and the Father. But you're conflating that to mean that as if he's saying that the Father is anthropos, and that's not correct. He's using that point about two witnesses. Really, the point is that
let me respond to that.
He's talking about two witnesses being necessary. This doesn't necessarily mean that he's saying that the Father is definitely an anthropos. I disagree with that.
Let me respond to that.
God said he's not. This is more or less Jesus speaking in an allegorical manner. So now, let me get to my
next
question.
Let me respond to that. Hold on. I'm going to respond to that.
Come on, this is our cross-examination. Let me get my cross-examination.
Let's go to
John chapter 20:17.
It's not preaching, though. They're questions
where
that
Jesus
are being
says
asked.
That he has
so
a God.
I get
Jesus
to respond.
Jesus says that he has a God. Why would Jesus, if he's God,
respond
that he has a God? Why would Jesus, if he's God, say that I have a God?
Shadid, cross-examination are questions, and the person you cross-examine gets to answer. But you don't get to preach, though. I'm going to respond to what you said. In response to John 8:17,
that makes the question, which was, what, are you trying to say
you're
that
right,
John 8:17,
right, and I'm
going to
answer it for you again.
Saying that Jesus is saying that he is one anthropos and God is the other anthropos, i.e. the other witness is a man.
Shadid,
you're
wasting your own time, because 17-18, first off, let me answer that for you. 17-18 is not allegorical. The Father is not allegorical. The Son is not allegorical. But
the Father
even,
is definitely one of the
hold on, let me answer that for you. Even if we were to take it as being allegorical, Shadid,
which means he's saying God is a man, then that's, you know that, right? If you're taking that position, Shadid,
let me answer
you're
that
wrong
for you.
Because you're saying God is a human, which is wrong.
Shadid, I've got more for you. But I've got more for you, Shadid.
Right? He's right. He can't be a human being.
17-18.
William, God can't be a human being. If you're going to use that argument, Shadid, then you're saying that God is one of the other human witnesses.
Well, if you allow
you're
me to
take
ask,
that Jesus is saying that.
If you allow me to talk.
That's my point. That's incorrect.
Okay,
God cannot be
here, here's the issue, Shadid.
Human being witness, William.
Shadid, it's cross-examination. I get
right, that's what I'm trying to do that, William, but you're coming in on my side. You told me to when it was yours to that, let you get your thing, so let me get mine. So now we dealt with that. Let's, like I said, we leave
let,
it. We
let, 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 the moderator, let the moderator talk.
That's why, just the rules of cross-examination is one questions and then the other answers. So just, I don't know if you guys are aware of debate rules, but the cross-examiner cross-examines by asking effective questions, and then the other one has to answer those questions. So Shadid, just give your question so that he can go ahead and then give him an opportunity to answer. And William, allow I'm putting a pause on the time. Allow the questioner to set up his question also so that it will be fair for him. And if he wants to set up a question, he might have to set it up with a statement. But,
that's
he
funny.
Might have a purpose behind his question first. So, all right, so then.
Not a problem. This is our first debate. We'll eventually get it down perfectly.
Yeah. All right, so I feel like we agree to disagree on that, but that's my point about that. I disagree on
but,
that.
What, so, let me just continue, though. I agree. Maybe we agree to disagree there. But the problem was this, Shadid, even if you do take it as allegorical, even if you do say, well, he's not being referred to as anthropos, despite the fact that the grammar clearly shows it, we can still –
you're taking it literally like that, then you're saying Jesus is admitting that the Father is the other human being witness, right? Because
Not necessarily a human.
But you said it's an anthropos, William. According to the
right,
what anthropos means that. It means a distinction between man and God. So I it could refer to God. I have not seen what anthropos, because it says in the actual entry that it distinguishes God from man. So I can't see how it could be used for God in another way.
That's why
unless it's just an allegorical manner. Like, for example, in the Old Testament it says God is a man of war, right? For example, in the Old Testament it says God is a man of war. You know, maybe that's an allegorical form, because obviously God is not an actual man, right?
The problem with this,
let's move on. Let me get to my question now. Because that was a carryover from yours. My question is for John 20:17. Is that the time? Oh, my question is for John 20:17, right? Where, as I said, Jesus says that he has a God, John 20:17. If he is the mighty God himself, can you answer, why is he talking like that? Why is he saying that the God of himself is also the God of his followers? That's hard to grasp for people who believe that this man is supposed to be the mighty God himself. So go ahead. Yeah, let's hear it.
Let me answer that. He says in 17, to not hold on to me because I have not ascended yet to my Father. He is telling them, I'm going to return to my God and your God. We know that God the Father is his God, and he's going to return to glory. So the whole passage, the whole verse in and of itself, Shadid, is a message to his deity. He's going to return to glory where he was before the world began. And we don't just read John 20:17 in isolation to the others, because as we go down, we read exactly what is said to his deity when Thomas appears and basically says, the Lord of me and the God of me. So all of this is connected. So if we're going to take verse 17, which we agree to, God the Father in heaven was his Father, is his God, is his Father. He was sent from the Father. That was his mission.
But but he's not supposed to be his God. If that was the case, he should be saying that I'm going back to be God. Instead, he's saying I'm going back to my God, rather than I'm going back to be God.
Well, that's
you see, the
thing.
He's going back.
Why? He's not going
to
say that because
to his God,
because we
rather
believe
than I'm going back to return to my position as God. You see what I'm saying?
Well,
he's
that's not what he's going to say. Yeah, you're wrong.
But no, that's what he's saying. He's saying, look, I'm going back
because
to my God.
Say,
and notice
he's not going to say I'm going
to
go back to
God.
Be God.
God.
He says he's not going to say I'm going to go back to be God.
It doesn't fit with your saying.
Okay,
I apologize.
William, you can begin your cross-exam here.
Okay, Shadid, I'm going to go back to Anthropos because I could tell that was a bit of contention. In Genesis 32, man is used 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times. It's used in the Hebrew as well and in the Greek. Both. It is used in the Hebrew and the Greek. It is used 7 times. And then we are told at the end, I saw God face to face. So here is the question, and this is why I keep going back to the fact that Anthropos is not exclusively for a human. How do you reconcile the fact that for deity, man, Anthropos, is used multiple times?
Well, wait, first of all, like I said, that doesn't work because the original Old Testament or Torah is supposed to be in Hebrew. It wasn't in the language of Greek, which is a completely different language. So that's why that argument
says man as well.
Because the original book was in it wasn't in they didn't use the Greek word anthropos, right? They put it in Greek, but the original writing was in Hebrew. So you would have to go based upon what it's saying in its first original form, which is the Hebrew, rather than the later Septuagint version of it. You see? It was
in Hebrew.
You got to go by what it's saying in Arabic. You can't go by what it's saying in English or French because it may carry a different meaning. You see?
Right, but it uses man in Hebrew as well, Shadid. Shadid, it uses man in Hebrew as well.
Okay, so let's say you want me to ask about that. It still says in the other places that I mentioned, Hosea 11:9, Numbers 23:19, Ezekiel 28:2, Isaiah 31:3, over and over again, that he's not anthropos. So we either have a contradiction or we have to accept they both can't be true. They both can't be true because the other statement is definitively clear. God is not anthropos.
So
they both can't
Genesis
be true.
32,
either one is false or the other is true or vice versa. They both can't be true.
So Genesis 32, are you making the assertion that Genesis 32, maybe the text in the Hebrew or the Greek is corrupt because it uses man over and over and over? What is your evidence for that?
Wait, what's your verse again? Genesis 32 what?
Genesis 32, 24 to 30, where is your evidence that this text would be corrupt? Where is the evidence for this?
Hold on, Genesis 32, you said 30? Okay, but this is
Genesis 32, 24 to 30.
That Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face. But see, now, again, this is another problem because other places in the Bible say that no man can see God and live. So you see, this is the problem that we have. We're trying to make evidences of these verses.
God the Father.
There are other things that contradict. How could he have seen God face to face when other places, I believe it's, what's that? Other places
well,
tell
my,
us that no man can see
I
God and live.
I can't answer that for you. Well, I can't answer that because it's my cross-examination. But going back to the point,
so
I could answer that for you. I can do it when you cross-examine. I'm going to move on because I can see that we're not going to come to a conclusion on Anthropos. Let's go to the Quran, 17:111. And as you go to it, I'm going to go ahead and read the Quran 17:111. And say, praise to Allah who has not taken a son and has had no partner in his dominion and has no need of a protector out of weakness and glorifies him with great glorification. Continue would be this, Shadid. Why is it that the Son of Man not only has dominion, he is worshipped, and he has rule over all creation? And the Quran says that Allah has no partner in dominion, yet there are two people who are given dominion in Daniel 7.
So your question is why is that? These are two books that are not in line with each other. Quran is making that point clear. But if we even look from a biblical perspective, Jesus again says that he has been given authority. Remember the verse I gave earlier when the people praised God because God had given man has such authority.
That's fine.
Again, notice the word
we
given.
Can take that
point. If you're God, you don't need
okay.
to be given authority. You already have it.
We can
a
go
manager,
with that.
A supervisor
we can go with
can
that.
Give you authority, right?
We can go with that. We can say
you
that he was given authority.
So Jesus would be like a type of supervisor, right?
Okay, we can
it.
Go
he
with that.
He's given that authority. He's given dominion.
Despite,
but he didn't have
right,
it.
Right. Despite the fact that I disagree, and I can
okay.
touch on that, I'm sticking to this point, Shadid. This is the one point I'm sticking to. The Quran
okay.
says that he has no partner in dominion. Even if you want
no,
to interpret this as somebody other than
the Quran, it's clear that Jesus has nothing, you know, in the dominion. No, any prophet has any dominion.
But let me ask a question,
the
Shadid.
Together, act like, you know what I mean? They're not the same book.
Shadid, I'm asking the question. Let me finish it.
Okay.
The Quran says, you can ignore it. You can say this isn't Jesus. I'm not talking about Matthew. I'm talking about Daniel 7.
Uh-huh.
Why does the Quran say that God has nobody that he shares dominion with, yet Daniel
right.
7 has a plural in the Hebrew and Greek that shows there are two that have dominion, two thrones. Why is that the case?
Daniel is a different book written by some other person at some other time.
But
we don't know
that,
if that's
wouldn't that contradict the Quran?
A revelation from God or not. We don't know if that's a revelation from God or not. Even in the New Testament, we see that there's no two thrones. For example, in the book of Acts, when Stephen looks up to heaven, what does Stephen see? Stephen only sees one person on the throne.
Daniel 7 is Stephen not a revelation
from
God.
I saw God and Jesus standing next to God, right? Jesus
Shadid.
Is standing next to God. He's not on the two thrones. So
you're,
perhaps Daniel
Shadid,
was
you're telling me, are you saying that Daniel is not, you're saying that Daniel is not the word of God?
It's a possibility.
I'm not talking about the New Testament, Shadid.
It's a possibility. There's no definitive evidence that it is.
Okay, wonderful.
All right, Shadid, this is your spirit now.
All right, back to me. All right, well, let's see here. So we talked about, we already talked about John 20:17.
As
so
possible.
Another one is Matthew chapter 27:46. Once again, we see that here Jesus, this is probably he's supposed to be in the crucifixion event, and he is calling out to, again, a higher power. He says he cried out to God, saying, the English is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Once again, I ask the question, why would the mighty God, if he is the mighty God himself, be crying out to a mighty God when he's supposed to be the mighty God himself? And why would he believe that the mighty God had forsaken it? And as a side note, I know people say, oh, this is a reference back to the psalm. To me, that doesn't fit, because still, why would God do that? Why would God, even if he is referring back to psalm, why would he put on a display like that, giving people the impression that he's still calling out to the mighty God, if he's supposed to be the mighty God standing or being crucified himself right there? Why would he even, just for the sake of a show, to say, well, I'm just quoting an Old Testament scripture to fulfill prophecy? Why would he use those phrases to show people who are watching could take that as it can be taken very clearly, that he's a man in his moment of desperation and need calling out to his God that his God had forsaken him? Why would, again, if this person is God, why would he want to do such a thing? Give me a
very simple Shadid. Yeah,
very
simple Shadid. And the reason is being, you say, why would he cry out to God if he's God? The reason he cries out to God is because he's crying out to God the Father. He wouldn't be crying out to himself, because we don't believe in modalism. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? And it's not a matter of why would he be crying out and saying a psalm, which people might not understand. Everybody would have understood Psalm 22. His cries to the Father and the reference, what he is quoting, only goes to strengthen his deity even more. Because despite crying out, Shadid, he's not quoting a prophecy. He's making a prophecy that has indeed come true. So if you read all of Psalm 22, what he's also doing is making a prophecy, something that only God could do, because what he's saying in the prophecy one, all the families of the nations are going to worship him, as this is told in Psalm 22. Two, the proud of the earth are going to bow down to him. That happened later on. We see that in history. Three, everybody is going to tell the Lord of the coming generation. We see that being fulfilled as well in the book of Revelation. And then what is being told in Psalm 22? to proclaim the deliverance to the people that have not been born yet. So all of this doesn't go against his deity, Shadid. It only goes to strengthen his deity.
I disagree. Because, I'll make it into a question. So it sounded like you were basically saying that, because you keep saying that God the Father, or the Father is God, or whatever. Are you then saying that, because this sounds like a form of subordinationism, are you saying that the Father is, in a sense, or in some way, above or greater than Jesus? Because you're saying that he's calling out to him. And then
no,
that would be my
what
point.
I'm saying.
Okay,
yeah, no, what I'm saying is that, what I'm saying is he's quoting Psalm 22. I'm not quoting subordinationism. I'm not taking that tact. I'm actually going completely against subordinationism, because the mere fact that he quotes Psalm 22 and shows the fulfillment of the fact that he's making a prophecy, that in and of itself, all of Psalm 22 is talking about Yahweh. Dominion belongs to the Lord. He is talking about prophecies that are going to be fulfilled in him, Shadid. So remember, he can cry out to God the Father, because what was Jesus? Jesus was fully God and fully man. 1 Timothy 2:5, he was the God-man that died on the cross. He was the only one that could have been our mediator. So God himself, the nature of divinity, didn't die on the cross, which is what is being made clear. The man, Jesus Christ, did. And him quoting this, I was saying, strengthens his deity, because he is leaving a prophecy that begins to get fulfilled almost word for word with some of these words in the book of Revelation, Shadid.
But again, this still doesn't fit. You just said it to that he was both God and fully God and fully man. If that's the case,
yes,
why does he need to call out? This is a negation of him being God, because he's showing a weakness. Remember, God is the all-powerful. Here, Jesus is showing that he's not all-powerful. He's crying, especially here. He's in a time of desperation, a time of need, and he's calling out that his God had forsaken him. My God, why have you left me? How could he be the mighty God and be left by God? And now it sounds like you're talking about another God, because you're talking about his God the Father. My understanding is that Christians believe there's only one God. So how is it that how is it that he's crying out to a God, the mighty God? Because the question of this debate is Jesus God? If he's God, who is this other God that he always seems to be talking about, as I showed from John 20:17, now Matthew 27:46? Why does he keep talking about this other person or other being as God if he's supposed to be? The question is Jesus a God or one of the gods? Is Jesus God point blank? But yet it appears that he's always referring to this other person or being.
Let me answer
as
that
God.
For you.
Why is that, William? Why
your time,
is he calling to this
your time's
other God?
Run out. Let me answer that for you.
Yes,
yeah,
so I'm asking,
let me answer
why are you always calling to this other God, William? Why
the reason he's always saying, my God, my God, he's not hearkening to himself, because he's referring to God the Father, as we show
in another God,
Daniel
right?
7. No, it is one God. There's only
one. Why are you saying God the Father? Jesus God? You said Jesus is God. So why are you saying
God the Father?
Is only one God?
Let me answer that for you, Shadid. I was trying to answer for you. As we see in Daniel 7, we've got the Son of Man who is Yahweh. We've got the Ancient of Days, the Father who is Yahweh. They're both in heaven. They are distinct persons. That is why he can cry out, my God, because that is another person, Shadid. It's another person, not another God.
You said both,
persons,
but it's two of them, correct?
Okay, Daniel 7 said there are two persons.
There's two of them, both. But the question
Shadid, two persons.
So there's more than one.
Shadid.
There's more than one, correct?
There's more than one person, Shadid. There is more than one person.
I heard that.
As the Bible says over and over.
There's more than one of them. There's more than one of them. Y'all heard that.
Yeah, there's more than one person. Correct.
Uh-huh. All right, gentlemen, this is the last two cross-exams. So, William, you have this cross-exam, and then Shadid has the last, and then we'll have the closing statements.
I'm going to go right back to the – well, first off, let me ask you this, Shadid. When we look at the Bible, not just the – we can even include the Old Testament, the Hebrew. When we look at anything, is the Greek term latruo, Latin latria, is it supposed to be used for anyone other than God?
I'm saying it again. I didn't understand your question. Say it again.
It means worship. Matthew 4:10 and the book of Genesis tell us, latria. Latril is to be given to God alone. So my question to you is this. If God is to, if latril, which is proper worship, is to be given to God alone, why is it in the Old Testament and the New Testament latril is given to someone other than the Father as well?
Why are you making an argument about that word?
It's the exclusive word for worship.
When you go to the Old Testament, you keep using the Greek verb. Why don't you go with the Hebrew? The Hebrew word rather
Let's
than
go with the Hebrew.
Because, again,
Pilak.
It was originally in Hebrew, not
we'll
Greek.
Go with Hebrew. Let's go with the Hebrew. Pilak. Let's go with the Hebrew.
Right. So
Pilak
now you can't conflate that with the Greek word because now it may have a different meaning.
Perfect. Is Pilak ever used for
you
anyone?
You take a Greek word
Pilak,
and conflate it with the Hebrew as if they may have the same meaning and then say, well, then you ask me this question based upon the Greek, whereas the Old Testament was in Hebrew, not Greek.
Shadid, is Pilak meant to be given to anyone other than God himself?
Now, that I have to look it up. I have to look it up to get all the definitions of the word.
Wouldn't you agree that if, because, I mean, you've used the New Testament yourself.
And by
the
way,
Old Testament. Hold on.
Sorry,
let me ask you the question. Let me ask you the question. You'll have a chance to respond. If latruo and this word are given to the figure of the Son of Man, and this means worship, and the Son of Man is distinct from the Ancient of Days, God the Father, and Christ calls himself the Son of Man, what is that telling us, Shadid?
But according to Dr. Anthony Buzzard, Jesus doesn't get latria, right? He never received that.
That's
There's
fine.
No verse that he received that. So then how are you trying to make this example that this is Jesus and referring to Jesus when, according to Dr. Anthony Buzzard, Jesus, there's no scripture in the New Testament that shows that Jesus received that type of worship?
Because I think Anthony Buzzard doesn't know what he's talking about, and I'm asking Shadid Lewis. I'm not asking Anthony Buzzard
because he's supposed to be the scholar, professor of the languages and the
scriptures. I don't think he's a scholar.
I refer to him rather than myself because I don't contain to be an expert or a scholar. So you're just giving your opinion that you don't know what he's talking about.
Right. We'll move on.
Does Jesus receive latria anywhere in the scriptures in the Greek?
Yes, he does. Anthony Buzzard doesn't know what he's talking about. I don't agree with
him. He does? Where does Jesus receive latria at?
In the book of Revelation, in Mark, in many other passages, Mark is hearkening to Daniel. Daniel gets latruo. That is what he's getting. In Daniel, the Son of Man gets latruo. All will worship him and the Ancient of Days. So you've got the Father and the Son receiving something that is exclusive to God alone, which is worship. As Matthew 4:10 says, latruo, latria, is meant to be given to God alone. So I don't agree with Anthony Buzzard. I don't think he knows what he's talking about. But that's why I was asking you. I thought that maybe you were aware of that word. I'm sorry. I thought maybe you had done.
Well, I may be pronouncing it wrong. Latria, I'm familiar with that. And I looked it up, and that's what, based on what Anthony Buzzard was saying, this is the type of religious worship that is, you know, meant for God.
Yes.
And he said Jesus
for
never
God
received
alone.
That. And Jesus says, right. I don't know, well, he said Jesus, I don't know if it means God alone, but it definitely is like a religious type of worship. And he said that
Let's
Jesus never receives latria. There's no place where it shows that Jesus gets latria. You know, he gets proskuneo, but so do other people. Other people get proskuneo as well.
Right.
But
that's
Jesus
correct.
Never gets latria.
Yes.
Jesus never gets that ritualistic worship of God. Jesus never receives that.
Well, he does.
So the book of Daniel, although it could, you know,
he
people
does.
Use it to
the
refer
book
to
of Revelation.
Jesus, you can't show with Jesus himself. People come to Jesus and do latria to Jesus.
Yeah, in the book of Revelation 22, he receives worship. Remember, latria is to be given to God alone. So he does get latria in the book of Revelation. As he gets latria, I'm quoting Mark. Remember, I'm going to Mark chapter 10. The Son of Man, and I don't want to preach because I know it's cross-examination. The Son of Man gets latruo. So whether or not Anthony Buzzard or not knew about that verse, maybe that could be a topic for a whole other debate. But the Son of Man does get worship in the Hebrew and it's not just in the Hebrew. It's also in not just in the Greek. You can find it also in the Hebrew. So that is very clear. Remember, that is hearkening to Daniel 7. So the prophet Daniel and Jesus Christ is talking about Jesus Christ. And, yeah, latruo is mentioned there for Jesus. And I would argue it's not the only place.
Mark chapter 10 what? What verse?
I believe it was Mark 10, 18, I think.
Mark
10, 18. It, well, actually, you know what? It was in my opening.
No, it can't be 18. 18. No, it can't be
no,
Mark 10.
It's not 18. You know what? I'm wrong. Mark 14. My bad. Mark 14, 61 to 64. This whole passage, Christ is saying, he is saying that he is the Son of Man. Remember, this is harkening to Daniel chapter 13. So he's the Son of Man, and the Son of Man receives worship. So the question goes right back to that. I understand that you haven't done enough research on it, so I don't want to harken on it.
I don't see in Mark 14 either where Jesus receives latreia here either. I don't see where it says
that. The Son of Man receives latreia. The Son of Man receives latreia.
In Mark 14, 61, you said?
The Son of Man is hearkening to Daniel 7. Daniel 7 is the one that received
the
latreia.
But where does it say he received latreia in Mark, though? I don't see where it says that he was worshipped here in these verses. Mark 14,
Mark
says 61?
No, hold on, Shadid. Mark 14 says Jesus is saying he is the Son of Man. He's going to descend because only God can ascend and descend. He's going to descend, and it says that he's the Son of Man. Daniel 7 says the Son of Man receives
latreia
worship.
So you're conflating the two and trying to act like this is a this, no. But see,
we can go to Revelation 22:3.
But in Mark itself doesn't say Jesus is receiving worship. Latreia, it doesn't say that here. So you're trying to jump back to Daniel and conflate the two and act like, well, look, it's speaking of the, it's using similar language. So therefore, no,
Shadid,
William, come on, William,
let's
come
go
on,
to Revelation 22:3.
Mark itself doesn't say Jesus receives a trail. So that's wrong. Everybody,
it doesn't
understand.
Count.
Mark itself doesn't say
Shadid,
that.
Shadid, let's go to Revelation 22:3.
No, hold on, wait. Let's finish with this Mark thing. Because you said Mark.
Oh. All right. It's your turn.
Well, I don't know. I'll bring it back before on my end.
Do I hope you do.
Yeah.
Hey, I don't know how many you have left.
I think it's the last one you said, right? It's the last one.
Last one. You'd have the last 12 examples, and you have closing statements.
All right, so it's on me now?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So, yeah, let's continue on that point then. I heard you correctly. I am on
Shadid,
my phone.
You're doing me a favor.
Too well. I am on my phone, so the sound is not great. But it sounded like you said that Mark 14, 61, 62, I think you made it say 63, says that Jesus received latreia. Or latreia. Excuse my pronunciation for those who know the Greek very well. Latreia, I thought it was latreia, whatever, right? Not human. I don't mean disrespect. Not whatever. But that's what I understood, right? But I'm looking at these verses,
no disrespect taken,
and I don't see where Mark is directly saying that Jesus received latreia or latreia.
Okay.
So
let me answer that for you.
So it sounded like. So let me tell you what it sounded like you did. It sounded like you're using Mark because he's using the similar language of Daniel, such as the Son of Man coming in the clouds and all that, and therefore you're taking that and saying, well, look, he's using the similar language of Daniel. Therefore, in Daniel said that this person gets, this type of worship. Therefore, it must be Jesus. But to me, I don't see that because Mark itself is not saying that Jesus receives that type of worship.
Let me reply to that.
Can you explain that? How is that you said Mark? Why didn't you just say that Daniel says that this person receives latreia rather than Mark? Because Mark doesn't say directly that Jesus receives latreia as far as I'm looking at those verses.
I apologize if I wasn't very clear. 61 to 64, the point of it is one point. The point is that Jesus is Yahweh. He descends and ascends, something only Yahweh can do. And since this is hearkening, it doesn't just sound similar. The language is exact. This is a reference back to Daniel chapter 7, 13 to 14. In Daniel, latreia is used. So if Jesus is saying, hey, guess what, guys? I'm the Son of Man. And the Son of Man receives latreia, I believe that's clear. But if you don't like that, we can go to Revelation 22, where the Lamb receives worship either way. So either way you look at it, I think, with all due respect, Anthony Buzzard doesn't know what he's talking about.
All right, well, as I said, I think that's a false type of conflation because
show me
it's
how.
Clear that in Mark itself, Mark is not saying, he doesn't quote the part that Jesus receives any type of worship. It just speaks about
Jesus
the Son
of Man,
supposed to be coming in the cloud, right?
No, he's,
right?
No, he's the Son of Man. That's just coming
that phrase,
in the cloud.
Son of Man, even that phrase, Son of Man, this term, Son of Man, I mean, it's clear by its words, Son of Man. This is not God. God is not the Son of Man. Yahweh is not the Son of Man himself. In fact, in the Old Testament, I believe it's in the book of Job, it says that the Son of Man is a worm compared to God. So how could Yahweh come as the Son of Man when, according to the book of Job, the Son of Man is a worm in the eyes of Yahweh, in the eyes of God?
I'm going to respond to that.
How can that be? How can God come as the Son of Man, yet the Son of Man is referred to as less than God, a worm, insignificant in the eyes of God himself? So God is now going to become the Son of Man himself? Explain that.
I'll explain that very clearly. the language, when it says that the Son of Man, and it's not talking about a person, it's talking about sons of men, by the way, in the original language. When it talks about them being worm, it's talking about the fact that man, to God, is insignificant. That is what it's talking about. But there's a big reason. There's a big reason why this verse is so important, Shadid. Because Jesus is not saying, guess what, guys, I'm a son of man. No, he's saying, I am the Son of Man. He's hearkening to Daniel 7. Not hearkening to the verse where he's taught, where the Bible talks about a worm, because he's using the language seated at the right hand of power. Remember what we talked about, Shadid. If he's seated at the right hand of the Ancient of Days, Daniel 7 says there are two thrones in heaven. This is the kingdom of God, the throne room. The Son of Man is seated right next to the Ancient of Days, and the Son of Man receives something only God receives. The Ancient of Days and the Son of Man are both called the Most High, and they both receive Pilak. They both receive Latruo. That is what Jesus is hearkening to.
So here's the next question. If, again, the question is Jesus God. If he's God, why is he just seated in the right position? Why, or in the main position? Why is he seated on the right hand of the power instead of being seated in the place of power instead? You see, if he's God himself, which we're asking, which is the question of this debate, once again, why isn't he just in that seat of the actual seat of power rather than being seated on the right hand of power? Because we understand the definition or the meaning of the person sitting on the right hand. My right hand man, the right hand of God, the right hand of power means that you're not in the power position, but you are close to the person in power, which gives you certain privileges and advantages and permissions that others don't have. But nonetheless, you are still not the power itself. You are sitting, you are the closest to the power, but you are not the power. And again, the question is Jesus God? So if Jesus is God, why is he seated next to the power rather than in the actual position of power himself, if he's supposed to be God himself?
Very good question, Shadid. And I think you've just answered it for yourself. Because when it says he's seated at the right hand of power, it's not saying he's seated at a subordinate level. Remember the vision, Shadid. In heaven, there are two thrones. And when it talks about the Most High in the Hebrew, that is a plural term. So there are two that are listed for the Most High. And then we can hop on over from the Hebrew into the Greek. The Greek says the Son of Man is not subordinate here, because what does the Son of Man have? He has dominion over all. And there's a reason we know he's not subordinate, Shadid. The reason we know he's not subordinate is because he receives something that is supposed to be given to God alone. And what is supposed to be given to God alone is Latruo, exclusive worship.
But hold on, but he is subordinate, because he says in John 14:28, the Father is greater than high and him and Stephen for only one throne.
Yeah, because he has to return to glory. Yes, that's correct.
Gentlemen, we are now into the closing statements period. And you will both be given 7 minutes to give your closing statements, and then we'll open up the lines for those who are listening. And as always, I'd like to give a warning to my caller. If you don't speak up, then I will have to go ahead and be the guy, the one who's going to ask all the questions, and I got plenty of them. So, you better get your number ones, get ready to push. William, you have the first closing, and then Shadid has the last word on closing statements. And so you have 7 minutes.
I will begin now. Thank you very much for that lively and very, very intriguing debate, Shadid. I look forward to many, many more with you, and I really, really enjoyed myself, had a great time. But in opening my closing, fittingly, I'm going to hop on over to Latruo. And hopefully you can do a little bit of research while I'm saying the closing, because I'm confident that even with a mountain of research, we will find that in the Gospel of Mark, what Islamic theologians, what liberal theologians, what all of these liberals believe as well, I'm not calling Muslims liberal, I'm saying all of them believe Mark to have been the oldest gospel. Anywhere you look, Mark 14, Christ is hearkening to the Son of Man. The Son of Man is Christ. It's hearkening to Daniel 7. Every person that interpreted this verse, and I want to remind you, Justin Martyr, when he dialogued with the Jews, he stuck to their version of the Bible alone. Guess what his text says? It says that the Son of Man, and he connected that with Christ, the Son of Man gets latruo, latria, worship that only goes to God Almighty, only to God Almighty. And if you want to say, well, Mark isn't saying it, even though Mark is hearkening to Daniel 7, good luck with Revelation 22. Good luck getting out of the grammar from there. Good luck getting out of the fact that the Lamb, Christ, is the recipient of latruo. There is a divine figure in Daniel 7. That divine figure was Jesus Christ. And I want the listening audience to go and buy Shadid's book. I bought it and read it. It's a short book, but it is very good. I have to applaud Shadid. Most books you buy off Kindle nowadays are full of grammatical errors. He wrote a very, very cogent book on the argument against the deity. The funny thing is, every passage he used is an explicit reference to deity. You could almost hear Shadid's desperation with John 8:40 and the fact that he refused to answer it. I'm going to answer it for you in my closing. What did Abraham not do that the Jews are trying to do? Well, Abraham's been dead a long time, as Shadid admitted. What did he not do? Well, it's not important. Well, it was important enough for you to put it in your book. Important enough for you to tell everybody, look, what Jesus says, but now you're trying to kill me as a man, but you ignore what he says elsewhere. Guess what? Jesus was a man. He appeared to Abraham as a man over 2,000 years ago. You're telling me that the last part of it is not important? Are you kidding me? You quote that in your book, and you say these are the words of Jesus on page 12, but the last part isn't important. What? This is not what Abraham did. What did Abraham not do? He didn't try to kill Jesus, but he's been dead 2,000 years. Come on. Really? Over 2,000 years, really? How, pray tell, did Abraham not do to Christ what they're trying to do if he's been dead for a real long time? Abraham was dead before Muhammad was even a twinkle in the eye of the world. Let us make the connection to what Jesus is talking about. Your ancestor Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. Well, he did. He did. Because the icing on the cake is Genesis 18, when God appears as a man with two angels. They appear as men. He ate food, spoke to Abraham. There is Yahweh speaking to Abraham, the way Jesus is talking to the Jews. Genesis 18 is the icing on the cake. There's no way around it. The Lord appeared as a man, ate food there, had a tangible body, a body that could feast on food and get his feet washed. And that is why Jesus said, you're trying to kill me. This isn't what Abraham did. This passage Shadid has been using for about a decade and used it in his book, but in cross-examination, he couldn't touch upon it. Why? I'm going to tell you why. It's when it says, this is not what Abraham did, that kills this argument. That shows Jesus is Yahweh. He appeared as a man. He existed in the time of Abraham. There's no way around that. Try every logical gymnastic. There is no way around that at all. That is why every interpreter from the ancient era, those that knew Christ, those that sat in his lap, those that heard him talk, Ignatius, Polycarp, all of them interpreted that. They said, wow, Abraham's been dead for quite a while. But we know why. We know exactly what Abraham didn't do. He didn't try to kill God. Instead, he spoke with him as a man. We hear a lot about Anthropos. That argument has been buried. Because in the Old Testament, even if you want to stick with the Hebrew, Anthropos is also used for deity. And you heard Shadid quote Vines. He quotes in his book. I've been quoting it for about a decade. Vines doesn't hold that argument. Vines has an exception there. Read the whole thing. Even the online one has that exception. So I hope he retires that argument, because I've been hearing it for a long time, and it is a fallacious argument. John 8 shows you. We were told that this is a powerful passage. This is going to really prove Jesus was man, and we're in trouble. Guess what? he did appear as man. He did appear. He did pre-exist. That is the whole message of John 8:40. So the passage Shadid used in his opening and his rebuttal refuted him. From here on out, he's going to have to cut the end of that off if he ever wants to use that argument and have it be a cogent argument. Why does Jesus cry out to God his Father? Well, I'll tell you why. Why doesn't he cry out to himself? Because he's another person. I got lambasted for saying there's two thrones, two people in heaven. Yeah, there's two people. These are two persons. This is why you have to understand the biblical language. Two people, not two gods. The Most High is one God, but it is used for two people. And that is why today's debate is so important. The Old Testament shows you the truth. The New Testament shows you the truth. You can ignore the church fathers if you want. You can ignore the enemies if you want. They only further support our position. And our position is, it's very appropriate for the day before we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. That was that Jesus did what only God could do. As the book of Baruch tells us, he ascended and he descended because only God can do that. And the Son of Man did that. The Son of Man is no worm, because this is quoting Daniel 7. The language is startlingly exact. Son of Man, and he receives literal worship. As the Bible tells us, the commandments tell you only God is to be worshipped. That is something very significant. Now we'll round out my closing statement by telling Shadid, I appreciate his presence. I appreciate the debate. And I hope to get to know him better. And I love him as a friend and hope to love him even more as a brother. And that will be it for my opening. For my closing, right. I'm sorry.
Thank you. And on time, too. So, Shadid, you have your closing statement. You have 7 minutes.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Well, I'll begin with addressing the statement about Anthropos in John 8:40. That argument will not be retired, because it still holds, because the point of me using that passage is showing where Jesus speaks very clearly in unambiguous words that he is a human being who has told them the truth that they heard from God. I look up some of the commentaries on the last statement of this did not Abraham, and the commentaries do not give the definition that William, or the understanding that William gives. All right? The commentaries on this verse show that this reference to Abraham, or this did not Abraham, or Abraham didn't do this, is in reference to the lack of obedience to the words of God that are being told to them by Jesus. Not that Abraham didn't try to kill God. The commentaries show that William's understanding is incorrect, so this argument will not be retired. I will continue to use it because it holds strong weight, because, again, it is clear that these are some of the strongest words that Jesus is declaring himself not to be God. He makes it clear that I am a human being, anthropos, who told you the truth that I heard clearly, that I heard from God. Again, if he were God, why would he say I heard the truth from God if he's supposed to be God himself? And again, the commentaries say that the reference to this did not Abraham, or Abraham didn't do this, is in reference to the fact that Abraham heard God's word, heard the words from God, and listened. Obviously, Jesus is not saying that the words that he's giving are his words himself as God, but he's saying, I heard these words from God, and I'm transmitting them to you from God. And the statement that Abraham didn't do this is in reference to their disobedience to the words of God that Jesus is giving them. That's what the commentaries say that this meaning is. Not that, you know, Abraham didn't try to kill God, but that Abraham didn't do like they're doing, meaning when the words of God came to Abraham, Abraham was obedient. Abraham listened and carried out, you know, it was faithful to God's word. And he's saying, you guys are not doing that. And that's why it goes on to talk about how they try to make their claim of their descendancy, you know, as Abraham as their descendant. And Jesus says, nope, you're not. You're of your father, the devil, instead. Why? Because you're not acting like Abraham. You're disobedient. Here, I'm bringing you the words of God, from God, that I heard from God, not myself as God, that I heard from God, i.e. a messenger. And you're disobeying them. Abraham didn't do that. When Abraham got the words from God, he listened. He obeyed. That's what the commentaries say on this verse. So I'm sorry, William. I'm going to continue to use it because it clearly still holds my position. Now, very clearly, everyone that's listening,
as we've demonstrated many times, we've had this debate for a number of years, and, you know, I'm still where I am because it's clear to me that Jesus is not God. As I demonstrated in this debate, those words that are used, that are alleged to be Jesus' words, they don't apply to the mighty God, the supreme being, referring to himself as having a God. Think about that. Saying that he needs, that he does the will of some other power or being. Allah, Yahweh, Yahweh doesn't talk like that. Allah doesn't talk like that. Even if you want, even if you're one of those people who say that the Muslims have a different God, okay, fine. But you believe that your God is the mighty, powerful one as well, don't you? And the mighty, powerful God never talked about another God being over him. The mighty God never says that he does the will of another being or God over him. The mighty God never says that his God, which of course he shouldn't have a God at all, is the same God as you, meaning you and your God have another God that's the God of both of y'all? No, that doesn't follow. And these are the type of language that Jesus has said to speak in your own scriptures. And so when we look at this as Muslims, we say, no, we can't accept that this man is God. The mighty, the most high. That's the point of the statement, most high, that there's no one above you. So you could never, the Most High could never say, my God. No matter what example he's trying to give, if he's trying to say, oh, he's speaking like that because he's in the man form or he just came down to earth. No, he still would be the Most High. He still shouldn't be using language that someone is above him because there's no one above him, right? He's the Most High, right? He talked about the Son of Man example and how the Son of Man is significant. Isn't that interesting, everyone, that he acknowledged that the Son of Man, those statements, he acknowledges those statements that the man, Son of Man, is insignificant compared to God or in the eyes of God. And yet he wants us to believe that the mighty God would now become the very insignificant thing that he wanted us to distinguish himself from. This doesn't follow, everyone. This is why Islam denies and rejects that idea that any man, not just Jesus, but that any man is God or could become God or that God would become that which he always wants us to distinguish himself from. That's why he's the one that's worthy of worship, because we are his creation. We are lower than him. He is above us. He's the Most High. That's why you can't compare yourself to God, and that's why you don't compare God to us, because it just doesn't follow. But again, that's the language that is attributed to Jesus in their book. Of course, you know, with the Quran, it's clear Jesus was a servant, messenger, all of that. But even in their book, he's shown to be using this type of language. And that's not the language of a mighty God, a God that is the creator, a God that is the Most High, the all-powerful. You know, it just doesn't follow doing the will of another, hearing the truth from somewhere else, calling out for help, praying for this and praying for that. No, God is the one that's prayed to and answers prayers. But Jesus needed help, he's praying. All right? He's saying that he can't do these things on his own. He's declaring that he's doing the will of the one that sent him. The one that sent is the messenger. The one that sent is in the lower position. Now, that doesn't mean that these persons who were sent by God are insignificant because they're lower in that sense. But, you know, this lets us see, though, in relationship to God, that they are lower than God because they're the ones that sent. They're the ones that have been given the task or the duty or the job to bring the message to the rest of us from God. But clearly, they are not in God's position. God, he sends them out. He delegates to them, go and give the message, go here, go there, etc. Because he's the powerful king, the ruler, the Most High. So I believe in this debate, as I've done in all the others, we've demonstrated once again that Jesus clearly is not God. A servant of God, yes. A prophet of God, a messenger of God, yes, indeed. And mighty, yes. Was able to perform great miracles, as were other prophets. But clearly none of them, including Jesus, are God themselves, are equal or on any level close to their God, as Jesus said, his God and your God.
Okay. All right, thank you, Shadid. Thank you, William, for a very vigorous debate. And we actually have 25 minutes and a couple seconds left for our listeners. And so I want to give those that are listening an opportunity to go ahead and question both of these gentlemen on today's debate. And all you have to do is dial in the number 347-934-0379 and press 1. Press 1 if you want to, so that I can unmute you so that you can go ahead and ask either of these or both of them question concerning today's topic. So 347-934-0379, press 1 if you want to ask a question. If not, I have a couple of questions. And, we have one already just pressed 1. Okay, you are on the air with Steve Lewis and William Albrecht.
Thanks for taking my call. Hello, Shadid. My name is Brian. I wanted to ask you a question about the method of Islamic argument against Christianity in general, including the question today. First of all, it's a multifaceted question. So first of all, what is your view of the panoply of Christian and Hebrew scriptures? Are they inspired of God or not? This simple yes or no question.
Can't, because it's not yes or no, according to Islam. According to Islam, there's a mix of truth and falsehood.
Okay. Yeah, that was my understanding, that Muhammad taught that some of the Hebrew and Christian scriptures had become corrupted. Is that your view?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let me ask you, what about in the book of John chapter 1, verse 14? Because the answer, the Christian answer as to what Christ is whilst he is on earth, whether it's a Trinitarian argument or an Arian argument, is the same, and the word became flesh. Kai halagos sarx eginetu, and the word became flesh. So that's the answer to the Muslim objection to the idea that he says that he's a man. Yes, indeed, the word became flesh. He became a man. So do you accept that particular passage of Scripture, John 1:14, or is that one that's been corrupted?
Well, two things. One, we would have to define the word. Is the word a word from God, that God gives a command, or is his prophecy that's becoming a reality? Or does this mean that, God? Is this word supposed to be God himself, the mighty God himself, who's becoming, who's turning into flesh? You see, that's the first thing. The second thing, which is part of that, is that, as I said before, that these are words that other people are saying about Jesus. These words are not attributed to Jesus himself. This is the word of the writer of this book who is making this claim, rather than Jesus himself. That's why during the debate I try to...
But that's specious, though, Shadid, because everything, even when a gospel writer... claiming to quote Jesus. I mean,
right,
we don't know. It's the same argument. It's the same argument.
Right, but you notice, though, during the I said these are the words attributed to Jesus, alleged. But the point is, at least they are allegedly a direct statement from Jesus, rather than these words in John 1 are just the words of like a narrator of a story. You see what I'm saying? Those are the words of a narrator of a story, rather than the words that I can say, well, at least these are attempting to be words that Jesus are said to be saying himself. Rather, here, this is the word of a narrator of the story saying that. So that's how I'm making that distinction factor.
Okay. Well, the argument, just to speak about the actual word, the Greek word logos, and what it means in the first chapter of John, yes, some adoptionist Christians claim that this is just a divine idea that became flesh.
Right.
But the narrative of the book of John, he clearly states that he was in heaven beforehand. And so that's the true interpretation. Whether he was God Almighty or part of a triune God or a special emanation from God, a special creation of God, nevertheless, he was a living person prior to his existence on earth in Christian theology and Christology. And so really, I guess what it comes down to, I just wanted to make sure I understood, you will quote scripture, our scriptures, whenever it seems to confound us if there seems to be a type of contradiction, what could be construed to be a contradiction, and the rest of the time, whatever our interpretation is that answers the Islamic argument, then those passages are spurious. I think in
no,
a nutshell, that's the way you look at it.
No, that's not how I look at it.
That's what it appears. I'm just saying that's what it appears. That's what it appears.
You just admitted, you just admitted that there's another interpretation. You see, you just admitted that even other Christians say, oh, it could be that it's God's idea coming into fruition or becoming a reality. So you're acknowledging that even other Christians have a different interpretation than you have. So it's not – it's not a matter of me just quoting it because it confounds you or contradicts you. It's a matter of many of the things that I quote, I'm quoting them either, one, because it's in agreement with the Islamic position. So it agrees with the Islamic position. So if it agrees, then I will use it, you see. In other cases, it may be something where it's to show because I'm aware of a contradiction between that verse and another verse or something of that sort. You see what I'm saying? So it's a combination of things. It's not just black or white. It's a combination of things on why I might use it. But many of the times I may use the verses because they're in agreement with my Islamic position, my Islamic belief, so I'll use it there. But like I said, you acknowledge that there is that what you're positioning is not the definitive only way it's looked at. You said yourself that there are some Christian interpretations that take it that the word coming flesh is as God's idea or God's thought or something coming into reality.
Can I touch upon that, Brian? Can I answer your question, Brian?
Sure.
Let me just touch
yes,
upon
please.
That real quickly. First off, let me just add one thing. And that is why I recommended everybody buy Shadid's book. I think Shadid's book is and it does. I don't mean this as a disrespect to him. I mean it as a compliment. I think Shadid's book is every passage he uses is a very strong affirmation for the deity of Christ. So I'm going to disagree with you on one thing, Brian. I don't think any of these passages confound us. I think they are very strong affirmations for the deity of Christ. And one other thing that I will add. I don't know if you said it or if Shadid misunderstood, but if you look at the early commentators on John 1, or if you look on John 8:40, or in any of these passages, or even the passage of the Father is greater than I, if you dig in, and I've written articles in all of them, if you look, there is not a single contrary opinion. In other words, every father, every philosophical figure that commented on them, every single one, we're on the same exact page for all these passages, which is why I think it is important to point out that these don't confound us. What we have to do, on the other hand, Brian, I think it's very important, we have to unpackage them. We have to read them in their context. Like, remember what we were talking about earlier, Brian, when we look at John 8, 8:40. It sounds real fancy on its face when it says, you're trying to kill me, a man. But you got to go to verse 39 where it says, where Jesus says, Abraham's our father. So Jesus said to them, if you were his children, you would be doing what he did. But you're trying to kill me now. So he makes one statement. If he was really your father, but your father's the devil, you'd be doing what he did. But you're not doing what he did. And then he says that. This is not what Abraham did. But you're trying to do what he didn't do. And remember, here's the interesting thing, Brian. The word is used in a verb form. In the Greek, he's literally saying, you're not doing the action. You're trying to do this, which is to kill me, which is an action. Abraham did not do this action. So that is very key. We must unpackage the text, and I think if we do that, we will really see with clarity what the text is saying. I don't think it contradicts itself at all. And maybe later on in the future.
No, I wasn't saying it was contrary.
The Bible contradicts.
Can I get a response now? Because, I mean, can I get a response to that? Because you're saying that those passages are a clear indication of deity, but there's no way you can look at those verses where, as I show, a man saying that he has a God, a man saying that he does the will of someone who comes, a man saying that my God is your God, a man saying that I do the will of
God's
the one. There's no way anybody could look at these verses and say, oh, these are a clear indication that this is deity. No, in what world?
I think maybe
in Greek mythology, where gods could have other gods,
familiar.
Gods could have children, and there were lesser gods and bigger gods.
Brian,
in Greek mythology, that might work.
Familiar with the text.
Let me get another caller and ask their question.
Okay,
All right, Brian?
All right.
I think any man familiar with the text would be able to understand it.
All right, caller 224, you're on the air.
Yeah, is this me? It's my turn?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello? Okay, hey, Shadid, it's me, your buddy Sam Shamoon.
Hey,
you want to
say? Hey.
Yeah, I just want to say Shadid happens to be one of my favorite apologists. I love the guy. He's a beast. And he's one of the best.
Hey, you
around.
Love me?
William, I love
you. Don't love me, Sam?
you too, man. But, yeah, there was a lot of interaction going on in the previous. I don't want to start another debate. I just want to, if it's possible, two questions for clarity. Like, I love the guy. He's one of the best. He's a credit to us. Very respectful and passionate, so I appreciate him. I just want Shadid to deal with this from his perspective in John 5, where in that text, where Jesus says he does nothing on his own, he can only do what he sees the Father doing. There he says that the Son gives life to the dead, to whom he wants. But then he also says that at the hour, those who are in their graves will hear the voice of the Son of God. That's verse 25, verses 28 to 29, and they'll come out at the hour. Now, Shadid is an expert to Quran. I can't teach him anything about it, but just to remind him, in 22 of the Quran, Shadid, I think it's Surah Al-Hajj, you'd know better than me, 22, verses 6 to 7 there, it says, Allah is the truth, Al-Haq, and that he gives life to the dead, and the hour is coming where he will raise them from their graves. So what I want to see from your perspective, there in John 5, Jesus says he's going to be doing very things that the Quran says Allah will do. He will raise people from their graves, and he gives life to whom he wants. So from your perspective, could someone less than God say these things, or do you think these are just words that were put in the mouth of Jesus? And I just have one more question after he answers that, if possible. I want him to answer.
All right, no problem. Well, of course, from the Islamic perspective in the Quran, right, this is only something that Allah would be able to do, unless he gives permission to somebody. You know, now Allah can do, if he wants to give permission or authority to someone, to have certain abilities or whatever, he can rightly do so. So, but in general, this would be, these would be the things that only Allah would do unless he would give permission. So if anybody could do such things, it would be by Allah's permission, that he could grant them such ability or such power or authority to do those things.
Okay. And if it's okay, if I ask the second question, and then I'll let you guys go at it, because it's Q&A. It's not, like last time it sounded like it was a gang up, but no, I don't want to do that. In that chapter you quoted in John 20, where Jesus said, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and my God, to my God and your God. I just want to ask, again, from your perspective, let me address it from two points. First, since Jesus says that his God is the Father, and he's the Father of believers. Now, again, like I said, you're the expert in the Quran. It is true that Allah is the Father to no one. So when Jesus says, my God is my Father, and he's your God and your Father, how is that compatible with Islam when Allah is not a Father of believers? And then in that same chapter, when Thomas calls Jesus my Lord and my God, do you see Thomas contradicting Jesus, or do you see that Thomas wasn't saying that to Jesus, or if he was saying it to Jesus, wouldn't that then open the door for that Trinity where the Father is believers of God, but so is Jesus, the Son, and they're not the same person? Are my questions clear, or am I confused?
I think I got you. Okay, yeah.
Okay.
All right, so
then that's it for me.
All right. So on the first part hold on. The first one is again about my God and your God, right? Hello? Hello?
I think he hung up to listen.
Oh, man, I just got a brain drop.
I'm here. I didn't hang up. Can you hear me?
Oh, So the first part again was about, say it again.
You know,
say the first part again.
The first part was, since the God of Jesus and the disciples is the Father, he said, my Father, your Father. And I know the Quran, Allah is not a father to any believer. How would that be compatible with the Islamic view that Jesus is a Muslim? That's the first
part.
Okay,
right, there you go. Okay, yeah. So the way I look at it is like this, is that when I read the biblical scriptures, I see how the term father is being used in a sense of endearment, in a sense of endearment towards God, a closeness to God, and looking at God as a father figure. In Islam, of course, we don't use that type of language. And we say we don't use that type of language because of the misunderstanding that seems to have developed afterward, where people begin to attribute actual fatherhood you know, to the mighty God. And so in Islam, we refuse, you know, we don't use such language. But looking at, you know, looking at the biblical language and how many people, even through the Old Testament, where God is, you know, referred to as a father type figure, I can see that it seems to be saying that this is in a loving way, that God is in a sense like a loving father in that type of example. So not taken in a literal sense, but in Islam, we stay away from using that type of language because of the misunderstanding that developed from it. So, you know, that's how I would look at it from the Islamic perspective. We don't use it because of the misunderstanding that developed, but when one actually looks at the scriptures and sees that, you know, this language is not only used of Jesus, but of, you know, of other people referring to God in a father figure sense, that it's showing really like a closeness, love that you have, you know, towards God in the way that one would love their father, but not taken literally or make God your actual father. The second part, what was the second one now?
If I'm still on, I don't know. But the second part was in that same chapter where Jesus says, the Father is God and believers are God. Thomas then says in John 29.
Yeah, I remember that part. Okay, yeah. So now the Thomas part, that's a longer answer. But the thing I say about Thomas is my position that this seems to be a problem, because when I look at that same storyline in the other Gospels, they leave out this part. So I take it that this may have been something that had been added to the story later, because when I look at the other Gospels, when they get to that part, it says that all the other disciples were there. Thomas wasn't late. Thomas never is recorded to have made such statements. This is only what we find Luke or John, right?
John, yeah.
John with Thomas. But the other Gospels, the other three, seem to leave this part out. They have no mention of Thomas uttering these words or Thomas being late. It just says when Jesus appeared, he appeared unto the 11, meaning the only person that's missing is, of course, Judas. So I take an issue if that event actually took place at all.
Okay, so do you think that...
I would put it under the category of a contradiction. I guess I'd put it that way.
Okay. Then do you think that since John 20 is the same chapter that, of course, Jesus saying, my Father, and Father, my God, that may too be not something Jesus said? Because it's the same chapter.
That goes into that. I know people may not like it, they don't agree, but then that would tie into what I told the previous caller, that in Islam, we take it that there's some truth missing the prophet. So it very well could be that, you know, I'll take John 20:17 as the truth, because it is a truthful statement that I agree, Jesus, the God of Jesus is the God of his followers, you know. Again, the father thing I explained, that, you know, the father, he says, is there his father and their father in that, you know, loving sense of a father type figure. And then I can look at the part with Thomas and say, well, there's that truth and falsehood mix. So that's how I look at it. Like I said, I know people don't like that. They don't agree, but that's my perspective as I look at it. Because you did say my perspective as a Muslim. That's how I look at it.
Thank you, man. I appreciate you both. And like I said, you're
no
a beast.
Problem.
And a good
all right,
and
thank you,
everybody.
Just want to let everybody know that this is the first time Sam's called, and I consider it because me and Sam go way back to the Trinity Discussion Board. So, first of all,
you, my brother, I didn't know it was you doing it, huh?
Yes, that's Estacio. You know, it used to be me, Sam, Robert.
Contact me on my Ben Malik page.
But I'm a former Jehovah's Witness, and so I highly recommend Sam's website, answeringislam.org, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, .org.
I highly recommend it.
And look
it
for me on Facebook at Ben Malik, because the Facebook.
If you're a former Jehovah's Witness, answeringislam.org is great for troublesome passages coming from the Jehovah's Witness. A lot of are very Unitarian, so that they kind of reflect also the issues.
Good hearing from you, brother. We'll stay in contact.
Yeah, good hearing from you.
Take care, brother.
All right, so we have 83. I got to give this last person a call. They popped in and popped out. 830, you're on the air.
Hi, yes. This is for William, and I have a question. Do the commentaries say the word man can't be given to God?
Very good question. I'm not sure if we were able, maybe the listener didn't get to hear the. I brought it up in my rebuttal and my closing. No, and that's particularly why I was trying to get to that point with Shadid, and Shadid had said that he had only read the online commentary for Vines. But unfortunately, even if you go to Vines, Vines makes an exception. Vines does not say anthropos is used for man only. In fact, it does make the exception, and it does say it is also used as a term for deity. If you go all the way down, it has a special spot under the section anthropos where it says son of man, which is the point I was trying to make, and it is in the exact same page where they talk about anthropos. It says this is also another usage, but it's not just vines. If you look at Strong's, but one I would recommend, and I would recommend it to Shadid, I'd like to give it to him as a gift. I'll be in communication with Master this debate. I'd give it to him as a gift. It's even better than vines, better than Strong's. It is lamps. Lamps, what that does, that will mine together the usage of certain words, not just in the Old Testament era. It'll get them from the Old Testament era, New Testament era. Then it'll also get their usage in the patristic era, going all the way to the medieval era. So if you check out how anthropos is used there, it is not ever a strict usage. There are over 30 different usages for anthropos, and it lists, I believe, over 300 usages where it does not use it exclusively to be dealing with a man or mankind in and of itself. So that word is I do agree with Shadid. I do applaud him for bringing that word forth. It is important to study that word, and I do want to gift him that book, and hopefully we can continue dialoguing on that.
All right, can I respond, please, to that?
Yes, go ahead.
All right, so I pulled it up again. I'm looking at it right now, and from what I'm seeing, I'm going to read all the – it's not too long, just some of the entries, and it does show
– Where are they? What are you reading, though? I'm on
BlueLetterBible.org. It shows that the number is from it's Vine's Expository Dictionary of the New Testament Word.
Oh, it's Vine's. Okay, Vine's. Yeah.
So these are the entries that it uses. It says, man, see also men, is used generally of a human being, male or female, without reference to sex or nationality. B, in distinction from God. C, in distinction from animals. D, sometimes in the plural of men and women, people. No one of men exists,
yes,
for example. In some instances, with suggestions. In some instances, these are all the things I got from Vine. In some instances, with a suggestion of human frailty and imperfection.
Look up section K.
Remember, this is
go
Vine. This is what
K.
I'm saying from Vine. In the phrase
you're
translated
right. It's
after men. Hey, William, please. In the
go
phrase translated after men, after the manner of men, as a man, according to men, is used
Shadid.
Only by the Apostle Paul of in the practices
Shadid.
Of
go to
fallen
section K.
Human, by, William, please let me finish. Let me show you. I'm
you're
showing
wasting
you
your time.
What Vine said, because you were making it seem like Vine didn't show that it
Shadid.
Can only be of a, of
you're
a human
wrong.
Being. Notice all these,
you're lying
not
to the
wrong.
Audience.
All these instances are human.
Section
for
K.
The woman who called, notice it says human frailty. Do you want to attribute
Shadid.
Human frailty as anthropos?
Section
do you want to attribute
man.
Human frailty to God? None
Shadid.
Of the examples in Vine show that it can be used
Shadid.
Of God. It says, look, listen,
section
listen, listen.
K.
It says anything
wrong,
of human
Shadid.
Origin. Anything
Shadid.
Of human
section
origin.
K.
Anything
Shadid.
Of human
section
origin.
K.
Can God be
you're
that?
Lying,
can
Shadid.
God be anything of human origin, ma'am?
Gentlemen,
so what I looked at from Vine shows no way it could be used of God.
Hello?
You're lying, Shadid. Section
no,
K shows it.
No, I'm not. I'll take a picture of it and I'll post it after this debate. I am not
go
lying.
Go down
now,
to section K.
Here. William, that's a strong claim, bro. William, that's a strong claim to say I'm lying.
I'm telling you to go down to section K.
I'm not
Shadid.
Lying. This is what I'm seeing here. Oh, okay. Maybe I decided to scroll down. Okay, well, then maybe
exactly.
I need to scroll down.
Got a minute.
Okay,
thank you.
I'm scroll down.
Thank
right,
you, Shadid. Section K.
The standard
okay.
generally
right.
accepted among men. The illustration not drawn from scripture.
Shadid, we're going to get cut off.
Okay.
Yeah,
we're
going to get cut off. I have to end the show. Just want to remind everybody, on Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. Eastern time, we have a live stream. We will also be on Blog Talk Radio. You can listen to us on iTunes. And we will be going through the Trinity and Jesus in the Old Testament. How fitting that is with today's theme. And so we will go into the Old Testament text, and we will find those troublesome passages that many of the old Jewish rabbis whispered about because they didn't want to sound like the heathen. Join us on Wednesday at 6:30. Everyone enjoy Holy Week. Resurrection Sunday's tomorrow. And you all have a blessed day. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.
All right.